Today, I want to talk about compilers. More specifically, I want to talk about all the steps that a text file goes through to become code that a computer can actually understand, from parsing to interpreting the semantics and all the way to machine code generation. I just really want to share with you the complicated but cool world of programming language compilers. This video assumes a very rudimentary understanding of algorithms and data structures from you, the viewer. But I aim to make it decently accessible to people at many levels of understanding of computer science. With that out of the way, let's begin. When I said that the world of compilers is complicated, I meant it, and the complexity starts to show up practically immediately. The very first step of compiling a program from a given text file with code in it is to parse the file. However, parsing is actually a rather difficult problem to solve. So therein lies our first piece of complexity. Let's talk about it then. The vast majority of programming languages are what we would call context-free languages. In this case, the words context-free and languages have a special meaning. Let's start with languages. In this context, it means a formal language, the same formal language that you may learn about in a high-level logic class or your computational complexity class. Effectively, a formal language is composed of strings, where each string is composed of symbols from a set of logical symbols that forms your alphabet. The composition of these symbols into valid strings in a given formal language is done by following certain logical rules. Man, I'm reading this right now, and this is still rather complicated garbage. Let's go back to the words context-free. I will throw more jargon at you with this next sentence, so please bear with me. I will explain it properly in actual human terms momentarily. A language is context-free if the left-hand side of a grammar rule can be substituted for the right-hand side regardless of what symbols surround the original sub-expression. Okay, that was so much garbage technical jargon that if you are not in the know, then I might as well have been reading the Apple terms and conditions back to you for the last little bit. What does it actually mean? It means that you can use a well-studied and understood concept from theoretical computer science, context-free grammars. In summary, a context-free grammar is a rather succinct way to describe the rules of a language and its syntax that lends itself useful to the construction of a parser. One might look like this. Hey, would you look at that? The nerds doing theoretical computer science came up with something useful for once. Anyway, jokes aside, this means that there is a more or less standard way of representing a given language. After all, a context-free grammar provides all the rules which, when applied recursively, could represent any syntactically valid program. However, syntax is not the same as semantics, and how a compiler deals with semantics we'll get to in the next section. One question should be brewing in your head. What relation does a context-free grammar have to parsing? I am glad you asked, because this jump from a grammar to a parser is not easy. Effectively, a lot of researchers came up with a way to construct parsers based on a provided grammar. Or more specifically, they came up with ways to reconstruct some valid parse tree for a provided grammar from a text string or a text file, if you prefer it referred to that way. Then, other equally smart researchers and developers created tools that generate parsers for you if you write a valid grammar. These tools vary in what sort of parsers they generate and what the parser returns. Most parsers give back to the user a parse tree, but some give an abstract syntax tree, which we'll discuss a bit later. I think that this section is starting to drag on a bit, so let me wrap it up by mentioning a couple tools and also how we'll proceed to the next section. As mentioned, there are a few off-the-shelf tools that are free that generate parsers for you. First is Yak, or yet another compiler. Then there was Bison, and now there is Antler. There are many revisions of Antler, the most recent of which is Antler 4, which generates all-star parsers, which hold no relation to Smash Mouth. Anyway, the ALL star parsers return to the user a parse tree that represents a program. Cool, so, assuming that we started with a program text file at the beginning of this section, after having a parser parse it, we now have a parse tree to give to the rest of the compiler to play with. So let's move on to the next section of the video with a parse tree representing the program in mind. From the previous section of the video, we have the parse tree. If the code had syntax errors, then the parser would throw an error, So, at least the parse tree we have now is syntactically valid. However, as already mentioned before, a syntactically valid program is not necessarily semantically valid. Let's have this simple C program as an example. It's super simple, and the syntax is valid. However, this would not compile, as there are semantic errors in this program. I mean, if this is the entire program, then what the hell are A and B? Who takes care of figuring out these semantic errors and interprets the rest of the program? The answer is the parse tree analyzer, provided by the compiler frontend. Okay, let me quickly clarify what a compiler frontend is. The frontend of the compiler is basically the combination of the parser, parse tree analyzer, and the intermediate representation emitter. You already know what a parser does, so what the hell are the parse tree analyzer and the intermediate representation emitter? Well, let's first take some time talking about the parse tree analyzer. In summary, a parse tree analyzer takes a parse tree generated by the parser and tries to interpret the semantics of the parse tree into metadata that lets the rest of the compiler toolchain correctly generate code for the passed in program. However, that is much easier said than done. So let's discuss what the general steps to analyze the parse tree are. The absolute first step when constructing a parse tree analyzer is to construct an abstract syntax tree, or the AST. This is effectively a developer-defined data structure that mimics the parse tree somewhat, but can hold whatever information in whatever format that the developer may want. Since the data structure is managed by the developer, they can even do some optimizations that make the AST look very different to the original parse tree. As an example, let's say that there is a statement in a program that looks something like this. The parse tree for this statement likely looks something like this. Would it make any particular sense to keep all these redundant addition operators? Not really, but the parser has to provide a parse tree that represents the initial program text in full, so the many additions remain in the parse tree. As a developer, you might not care at all how this constant was formed, and when going over the parse tree, just collapse the sequence of additions into a single AST node that looks something like this. And this subtree can also discard the equal sign. The meaning of the program is the same, but the representation is smaller. Anyways, the parse tree analyzer will generally be a sequence of steps: initial AST construction, symbol table creation, AST symbol resolution, and others as needed. Each step is just a traversal over the AST, aside from the initial AST construction, which is a traversal over the provided parse tree. These traversals will generally be done by using either a visitor or a walker design pattern, both of which are fairly well known. I prefer the visitor pattern myself, as it makes the most sense to me intuitively. Either way, I actually provided the way I personally construct the set of steps for a parse tree analyzer, but nothing stops a developer from coming up with their own way to analyze a parse tree. However, there will almost always be a symbol table, and symbol resolution based on information from the symbol table will happen at some point as well. So, what is the symbol table? It's basically a developer-defined table which stores all the relevant information for each named entity in a program. As an example, it can contain references to named variables, function names, classes and their inheritance structures, and whatever else the developer feels is relevant to the language they are making. Now, what is symbol resolution? In effect, it is figuring out what a named variable that is part of an expression is actually referring to. As an example, in this code snippet, the symbol table will contain the variables A, B, and C. When analyzing the expression on line 3, when the letter A is encountered, the compiler can look up what A means in this context, which will return that A is an integer variable defined on line 1. Similar thing will happen to the letter B. Both A and B are symbols that have been resolved to refer to their definitions on lines 1 and 2 respectively in the context of line 3. That's all that symbol tables and symbol resolution are. Alright, that's enough on the parse tree analyzer bit. Let's quickly talk about the intermediate representation emitter, as that's the last part of the compiler frontend that needs discussion. In essence, some smart people decided to make compiler construction modular and make a lot of components reusable, along with decoupling the binary generation from interpreting the source language. With these goals in mind, the idea of an intermediate representation arose. The one I am most familiar with is the LLVM-IR. It is basically a single intermediate language that is easy to understand and optimize for by all the backends, and a lot of compiler frontends generate it. So, the emitter will basically take the AST you have produced from the parse tree analyzer and convert it into the desired intermediate representation, which is honestly closer to assembly with extra structure than a typical programming language. But still, this makes it so that you can simply write the frontend of your language and leave the backend to LLVM. Here's a very common diagram that is often used to kinda show how this works. Alright, now that you understand how a compiler interprets and understands the parse tree, we need to take a step deeper into code generation and get lost in the weeds of compiler optimizations. So, let's get to it. Okay, now that we have gone from text to parse tree to AST to intermediate representation, we have a very difficult journey ahead of us talking about the optimizations. Let me explain a bit about why this journey is difficult. The backend of a compiler is a complex beast, taming which requires rather good knowledge of computer architecture, assembly languages, and being able to work with intensely abstract concepts that are incredibly unintuitive at first. Let's immediately start with a concept that is actually quite important and related to the intermediate representation. This concept is called static single assignment form, SSA in short. This concept is actually simply a restriction on a language. The restriction is that any variable is assigned to exactly once and that every variable is defined before it's used. Describing it is easy. Comprehending all the implications of it is not. Also, typically, SSA is only used on intermediate representations. This is mostly because no normal developer would want to write code in SSA by hand, and SSA is implemented with functions that cannot be possibly actually implemented on a CPU, so no assembly language could ever support it. Therefore, at some point in the backend logic, the IR is transformed out of SSA to be actually converted into assembly. Anyways, that was a bit of a tangent. Back on topic, LLVM IR is actually in SSA from the start, and the whole purpose of SSA is to either enable some optimizations or make others much easier to implement. After all, the properties of SSA make it significantly easier to analyze code. Here's a quick list of optimizations and operations that benefit from SSA. Constant propagation, dead code elimination, global value numbering, partial redundancy elimination, strength reduction, and lastly, the register allocation step. I will briefly discuss register allocation, but that will come later. As for now, I need to talk about the bread and butter of backend optimizations, the control flow graph. A control flow graph is a graph where each node is a basic block. A basic block is straight line code with no branches, jumps, branch targets, or jump targets. The edges in the graph represent possible control flow from jumps or branches. Cool. That sounds neat, but how is this useful? Well, it's useful because it enables reasoning about a large number of optimizations and analyses of code. As an example, when you have a control flow graph, you can very quickly perform reachability analysis, liveness analysis, calculate dominator graphs, and more. So, now that we have all this information, let's quickly talk about a fairly well-known compiler feature that is actually implemented specifically in the backend to help with generating good assembly code. We will be talking about register allocation. I apologize preemptively for this next section. It's a difficult topic and I can't explain it in an easy way quickly. In essence, there can be a lot more variables in a program than registers that are available on a CPU. So, by pigeonhole principle, at least one register will need to hold two variables at the same time if there are more variables than registers. But a register is small and can't actually do that. So what do you do? Well, the answer is to store some information in memory, which is called register spilling. However, we are getting ahead of ourselves here. Let's get back to register allocation. Effectively, register allocation is the problem of assigning registers to variables in the most optimal way possible. There are two types of register allocators, local and global. Local register allocators will do register allocation for every single basic block with minimal context of other basic blocks surrounding it. A global register allocator will allocate registers keeping the entire control flow graph in mind. For the sake of simplicity, I will only talk about local register allocators today. Well, the general idea of how a register allocator works is that liveness analysis is performed on each variable in a basic block. From that, live ranges, or ranges of instructions where each variable is alive, are calculated, and an interference graph is constructed. The interference graph is basically a graph where each node is a variable in the program, with edges being added between two nodes if they are both alive at the same time in any program statement within the basic block. Once the register allocator gets a hold of the interference graph, only one step remains, and it's the hardest step: assigning registers to each variable. This can be done by finding a K coloring of the interference graph, where K represents the number of available registers, or colors, for the graph coloring. As a heads up, calculating the K coloring of any graph where K is greater than 3 is an NP-complete problem. Therefore, it might be infeasible to get an exact solution, so heuristics are introduced to try and solve the problem that way. However, even those heuristics are actually rather difficult to compute, so register allocation is still very difficult. This is where SSA comes in to help out due to certain properties of SSA being very useful in calculating the heuristics for K-coloring. Additionally, the register spilling concept I brought up earlier is also very useful, but that is again going a bit too far. So, as you can see, this is a complicated step, and that's just one step done in the backend. There are many other cool techniques, steps, and optimizations that get executed on an intermediate representation to generate a binary that can actually run on the computer. And that's about it for the topics I wanted to discuss in regards to the backend of a compiler. Oh man, this video turned out much longer than I initially intended for it to be. And it was very difficult to get right. There is so much depth to the world of compilers, and I really hope that I managed to get some of it across to you. In the end, I hope that you either gain some appreciation for compilers, or learn just how interesting they are and how deep you can dive into each part of a compiler. So, if you found this video useful, interesting, or insightful, then please consider liking this video, and maybe even subscribing to my channel. Thank you for your time. Bye.